Well, hello everybody, it's Richard here. Welcome back to my channel. And today is day 17 of a tuna day, keep the coronavirus away, or COVID-19. And you join me on a very sunny afternoon. It's about 25 degrees here. Well, it is 25 degrees here in the United Kingdom in Maidstone. And you join me once more in my office come music room. So relax for the next few minutes while I update you about things in my world and what's been happening. And I've written a list today so that I don't forget anything and make any fatal mistakes during the broadcast. First of all, I'm wearing a very nice t-shirt and a nice pair of shorts and a pair of red shorts, which I'll post a picture of that for you so you can see that I actually how good I'm looking today. And I've not been for a run this morning, but I did queue up at the supermarket for about an hour today, I suppose. And it's fair to say that all the things I wanted were in the shop today, so that's quite good. There's plenty of vegetables and other things, and even some kitchen roll, which I was looking forward to getting. So on that note, thank you very much for your comments about the Ann Shelton reel-to-reel broadcast that I put on yesterday, and the second part of that will be played this afternoon, and it finishes that same broadcast with Desmond Carrington and talks about her time working for the Not Forgotten Association. You may have remembered I mentioned that a while ago, and she was their main organiser there and looking after the ex-service community, and she's well remembered for that and her lovely contralto voice. And she plays some more numbers there as well. That broadcast, I recorded it from BBC Radio 2 FM in 2009, but it actually goes back much further than that. The original broadcast that Desmond mentions actually took place 20 years prior to that. So, and Anne had been has been gone a long time since then, as you probably know from the last post I made, and I put in the description about her life. So so I mentioned that. Just to mention that the brass plate that I talked to you about for the gramophone from Crawley, I've now inserted into the Decca 73, and I'll post a picture of that so that you can actually see that in place, because I thought it would be lost otherwise, just leaving it outside on the Columbia 119A. So I took it off that, I polished it up as I showed you, and then I put it onto that gramophone, so it's saved. Though it's not technically correct, I'm sure they would have sold Decca 73 gramophones as well. One of my YouTubers mentioned the re-entrant bit on the front of the cover of, I think it was Stuart Ellis may have mentioned that. Stuart, if I got that wrong, I'm sure you'll tell me. But I'm not sure whether this would have been a re-entrant horn in this machine. I think it probably dates, well, this machine dates from 1930 circa, and certainly that was the style at the time, and that will be in the same for the HMV 165, I think it would have been, and those, you know, similar machines sounding very mellow, and because they've got such a deep horn, very large horn in there. So today, because it was so nice, I decided to do some spring cleaning. And I've got the vax machine out, and I've done the carpets downstairs now, the whole of downstairs, all those rooms have been done. And tomorrow, after I come back from my nice early run, I'll attempt to do up here as well. I normally clean my carpets, wash them about once a year. You'd be surprised how much dust you get off and dirt, so on that basis. If you could hear music in the background, it's from a famous series that was on, I think it was HB were doing a film, and the film was called Band of Brothers. And so this afternoon I thought I would actually review some of the DVDs that I like watching, and so I thought I'd do that with you this afternoon. And so without further ado, I'm going to the first one that I've seen recently is Judy, and this is about the life, the last part of the life of Judy Garland. And Renee Zellweger, I think they pronounce that, I'm sure you'll tell me if I've got it wrong, did an amazing job, and I thoroughly enjoy this DVD. I think one of the acid tests, and I'm not sure how you'd feel about these, but one of the acid tests is if you want to watch it again rather than perhaps give it away to a friend or the charity shop, that's normally a way that tells me that you know, it's worth a watch. I also watch, as you know, several of Netflix, and I've just finished watching Caliphate that's been showing on there, and also Unorthodox, which we've got a write-up a bit of today because the number of people watching Netflix. But on the DVD front, certainly Judy is worth a watch. It gets a 10 out of 10 for me on the score, and I did review that a little while ago on my channel, but that's certainly worth watching, that one. It's rated at 12. The second one that I think's worth watching, and that's one that stars Judy Dench and Ali Faisal, and that's Victoria and Abdul. This is a really lovely DVD, really lovely film, and gets a lot of star reviews on there as well. And thoroughly, I like watching that. Thoroughly, it has been on terrestrial television as well, but it's certainly worth a watch. And her affair with him. There's some very funny parts in this film that I won't spoil for you, but it's worth watching and very, very good. On the war film front, as I mentioned, Band of Brothers, and I do like the music from Band of Brothers. So I've got the CD, playing on the Sony at the moment. But the actual film itself came in a box set, and I picked this up at my local charity shop. I think it was about £3. It comes in this lovely presentation box, and if I can just open this for you, there we go. Of course, Damian Lewis stars in this, who I'm a great fan of because I think he's an amazing actor. And it comes with, let me just open this up to show you. I can do it that way. It comes in this wonderful presentation kit. So you've got about 6 weeks there if you wanted to watch one a week, unless you wanted to binge on them. But I certainly will be watching this again at some stage. And as it came in this lovely box, there's some moments in here where you really get the atmosphere from Easy Company, and I'm sure a lot of these scenes actually would have been played out from D-Day onwards, and the tragic loss of American soldiers. They go to the Hitler's Bahnhof, and in the Eagle's Lair, and you see them up there doing things up there. Amazing history. And if you've watched this, and also Mark Felton, Professor Mark Felton's YouTube channel, you get a real sense of what it must have been like. I think there's a scene in here where the soldiers actually, I think it's in this film, carrying in the stairwell, and there's a German sniper up above in in this building, and the sort of real fear this chap has in, you know, being alone, and the fact that he might get killed or he's going to have to kill the German soldier. So yeah, so that's very good. And one of the films I do love, as you know, I like spy stories and also that type of thing. So Valkyrie is one that's certainly worth watching. Von Stauffenberg, you know, is played by Tom Cruise in here. Certainly worth a watch. And I've watched this a few times. And never, Eddie Izzard is actually in here as well as an actor. And never fails to keep my interest. And I think that's quite important too. And they're a firm part of my collection. If you've got any DVDs that you'd recommend, then I'd be happy to know what they were, so that I can also watch those. I've got The Joker to watch, and also Star Wars, Luke Skywalker. I've just picked that up in Waitrose, so I'll be watching those two over the next few weeks, maybe, if I've got time. But it'd be nice to hear what you think. I hope you're still continuing to enjoy these broadcasts every day. We're on to day 17 now. And I'd like to hear whether there's anything of interest that you would like me to showcase for you about things that I get up to and my music collection. Yes, I do have a lot of different ways of playing the format. One of my Facebook friends, Rob Parsons, has mentioned to me only yesterday. And yeah, he's based in Canada. And yeah, I mean, I do. I have quite a range of machines that I like playing. And also all of the ones you'll see in these videos have been bought when they're not working and I've put them back on the road. So they're all a labour of love. They're all part of my family. And they're probably what I love doing, apart from tinkering with cars and everything else. So, and of course, working quite a long hour sometimes with the day job. But until tomorrow, look after yourself, take care, and we'll speak tomorrow for day 18 of a tuna day. Keep coronavirus away. Anne Shelton, radio transcription from Desmond Carrington, 2009, part 2.
But starting so young, being only 12, I couldn't be a Force's sweetheart. I became the Force's favourite. And I am now the entertainment officer of the Not Forgotten Association. And I put in 2 shows at Buckingham Palace each year. So I've never really left the Force's, because we look after the medically discharged and disabled men and women from the Army, the Navy, the Air Force, and the Royal Marines, and nurses, and everything. And Her Majesty graciously allows us, we're the only charity that she will allow to use the palace for us. So it's quite wonderful.
Anne Shelton, 20 years ago, when she spoke those words, but of course it is now she who's not forgotten, certainly in Britain, and also in America, where she was very popular.
Yeah, I went in 1952. We went over to plug a record for about a month. And I stayed there for a whole year, and we just played every place. New Orleans, New York, I opened the Copacabana. You name it, I've been there. I was the very first one ever to play the Copacabana. And I was told by the owner, a gentleman called Jules Perdell and Jack N. Trotter, who later owned the Sands Hotel, there were only 3 girls that ever held a Copa audience. One was Jane Furman, one was Lena Horne, and one was Anne Shelton. So that's quite a good company to be with.
She is all they claim, with her eyes of night and lips as bright as flame. Tangerine, when she dances by, Senorita stare and Caballero sigh. And I've seen raised in every bar across the Argentine. Yeah, she has them all on the run, but her heart belongs to just one. Her heart belongs to Tangerine.
A film song from the 40s. One of many nostalgic ballads that Anne Shelton's audiences loved to hear her sing. Indeed, it was inside a theatre during a band call just before one of her concerts that Anne spoke about her choice of songs.
I have never pitched my act, as the woman called it, to a wartime theme, you know? I mean, I've always put in new numbers and different things, but of course you cannot leave out those songs that have so many memories for so many people. Noise you can hear of the band rehearsing in the background. And I had a funny experience. My husband was producing a show in Canada. Well, the first show that I did, I sang You'll Never Know. And a lady and gentleman came round to see me, and they said, "Oh, Miss Shelton, we remember when you had your 17th birthday, you were at Wood Green Empire, and we got engaged, and you sang that song for us." I said, "Oh, how lovely." And so they said, "Of course, now we're grandparents." I said, "Oh, that's absolutely marvelous. I And this great big handsome hunk of Canadian sort of manhood opened the door and said, Hayes, I gotta tell you, you're just about the greatest thing I've ever seen. And that song, You'll Never Know, that's gonna be a hit. I thought, my God, that was written before you were born.
Never know just how much I miss you. You'll never know just how much I care. And if I tried, I still couldn't hide my love.
Young people in my audience, you know, and I played Wimbledon just a few weeks ago, and it was a 17, a 14, a 20, and a 23-year-old came up to see me, and the 14-year-old girl said, I just don't believe it, I've never seen anybody like you. You see, they used to sort of like seeing funny-dressed people, which is fine, you know, for the kids, because that's what they want. But they also might be having it as well, you know, but when they can get it. And I think it's a shame there isn't more of it, truthfully.
Well, I think the truth is that some radio stations don't recognise that the songs and tunes of the past deserve to be heard again. And I hope programmes like this one are evidence of that. A few final words from Ann Shelton 20 years ago, when she was asked about her career and the future.
I don't know, I think it's in the hands of our blessed Lord. You know, I think you have to love it, and if he gives you a gift, and it does become your life, it really does. But I've never had a lesson in my life. And I have a very dear friend, Tessa Carhill, and she keeps saying to me, why don't you come into opera? You've got such a range, you must. So, you know, I think it's what God intends. That's why when David and I got married, we decided that we would not have. I never ever wanted any children, and I adore children, but I could never be the mother that my mother was to me. You do have to dedicate your life to it. You can't play it halfway down the line. You have to love it, that's all.
I'll be seeing you in all the old familiar places that my heart and mind embraces all day through. In that small cafe, the park across the way, the children's carousel, the chestnut tree, wishing well. I'll be seeing you in every lovely summer's day, in everything that's light and gay. I'll always think of you that way. I'll find you in the morning sun, and when
late Anne Shelton with one of many favourite songs that so perfectly suited her golden contralto voice.